Hello everybody and welcome to HT2201, Theories of Contemporary Architecture, and the lecture today on the Undercommons. The Undercommons as a spatial, social, cultural, architectural, environmental concept which encompasses a particular approach to architecture, the history of architecture, and also the future of architecture. And we're going to approach this concept in a specifically architectural context and also in the narrower context of LA in particular, and therefore our own position with or in relation to the Undercommons and the kinds of possibilities that it affords for speculative architecture. So let's go straight to the mirror board. Now, the concept of the Undercommons comes from the work of Fred Moten and Stefano Hani in the book The Undercommons, Fugitive Planning and Black Study. And the concept of the Undercommons is a deeply complex one. And if you've looked into the text and begun to read it, you'll see that The Undercommons, as a book, is extremely challenging to read. It's a very beautiful text. The language is extremely rich, and it's full of many possibilities of interpretation. We're going to use it today, or for the purposes of this lecture anyway, really to emphasize two things, two fundamental architectural concepts, and those are the concept of the surround and of antagonism. And the film that you're seeing in the background is one of the two films that Moten and Hani refer to in the very first lines of the Undercommons, and they use it to refer to a specific US history of antagonism that exists in the surrounding and the conflict between different historical cultural formations, meaning in this case the white settler colonial Americans, who are symbolized by the architecture of the fort and the house and these recognizable settler colonial architectural typologies, the antagonism between them and between what I referred to in the film as the Indians, and a highly kind of stereotyped, prejudicial in representation of Indians as this, as you can see, this chaotic force that comes from the surround in order to disturb the order of the white settler colonial who wages war against the surround, against the people who are already there, and eventually restores this sort of frightening kind of white cultural order. So these form the terms of a particular kind of American spatial situation, which is the fort, the typology of white settler colonial architecture, which is surrounded by a threatening outlaw culture, which paradoxically, of course, is the culture which has already been there, which precedes, which is before and under and around the colonial invader. And that the relationship between these two entities takes on the quality of an antagonism. And this antagonism that takes place, that disturbs the ground, creates the conditions for the possibility of outlaw planning. And it's really this planning, this operation of planning outside of the law, outside of the established system of order, outside of the colonial imposition of a kind of foreign domination, that the Undercommons emerges. The Undercommons is outlaw, it's outside, it's beyond, it precedes, and it contains a level of potentiality and power to disrupt and disturb. And that is really the subject of our work today, to consider the Undercommons as a space of outlaw planning for disturbing entrenched dominating orders. Now, to think through that, we're going to hook up with some of the previous thinking that we've already done, and that is to think of the surround, the site condition, as a material condition. And we've already spent time thinking about ideas of materiality and the different materialities that can exist within architecture. And you remember that one form of materiality that we were looking at was matter as evidence, as information, the physical material constructs of architecture, having, as it were, bodies which record walls, floors, structures, materials that encode within them the history of a building, what happens there, what happens to the building, what happens inside it, what happens to the people and the users who interact with it. And we centered in on this image from the Battleship Potemkin, where the scene of contention in another kind of struggle, human struggle, in this case revolutionary Russia, centered on a particular way of looking at matter. And this is the ship's doctor and the film camera pressing the lens of inspection, the lens of investigation, into the maggot-filled materiality of the meat, in order to present the meat as the basis of the antagonism which is happening on board. We're going to continue that way of looking, but instead of looking at meat, we're going to be looking into the materiality of LA architecture and reading this matter, this materiality, these surfaces as markers of the antagonism that is kind of happening within LA's architectural history and the contemporary moment, as well as to inquire into the possibilities for a kind of radical architectural thinking that can come out of that. And we're going to center ourselves for the moment in Southeast LA, in the area of Watts, and explore some of its particular conditions. And in particular, we're going to focus on the Watts Towers. You may have seen them. If you haven't seen them, you must go and visit an incredible monument for us in LA and center of long social history, which continues. And as you will know, the Watts Towers were built over a period of 30 years by Simon Rodia, an Italian immigrant, a bricklayer, a mason, and a visionary architect. Now, their role in creating a cultural space within Watts is an extraordinary story, and it gets perforated by these moments of deep antagonism within US history. And the 1965 Watts riots, when the inhabitants of Watts, an extremely kind of diverse area with African American population, Hispanic, Filipino, but a population that had long been collectivized by its common experience of systematic inequality and kind of entrenched abandonment by the state, lack of resources, rose up and rioted against the unfair conditions of that they experienced in all areas of life, including urban and architectural. So Watts as an area within LA architectural and urban history, is itself the site of multiple antagonisms. Now, out of that condition, out of that environmental urban condition, we're interested in the architectural creativity that can emerge out of those conditions, that can take advantage of the conditions that exist, whether or not they may seem to be well-funded or well-resourced in any way. But to see architecture, to see the act of making and creating as the possibility for the creation of an undercommons, of an outlaw planning space, of an alternative environment, and to put forward the proposition that architecture in and of itself as an act of building and as an act of creation has the potential to create radically different spaces for human habitation and collective existence. So let's look closer at the Watts Towers as an example of this, and go through some of the basics of the story, which is that the towers were built by this man, Simon Rodier, working on his own over a period, sustained period, almost every day for 30 years, with basic tools, and I mean hand tools, you know, no machinery. Hand tools and salvaged materials, or salvaged materials combined with basic building materials like cement and steel rebar. And out of this combination of basic building materials and collected, sourced kind of ornamental surfaces attached to the concrete and steel and picked up from the local area, and with this extraordinary intuitive sense of engineering, Simon Rodier was able to produce this, well, what became known among some in the Watts area as the Jazz Cathedral. Had many names, was appropriated and deeply kind of identified with by the local population, who over this period of 30 years had watched this act of architecture come into existence. There's a fantastic film that's been made about the towers. It's called I Build the Tower and contains amazing documentary footage of Rodier. We're going to just listen to some excerpts here to bring out some particular qualities that we can then go on to develop further.
And my first recollection of the whole thing was, what a pile of junk. He had this little house, living alone, living very frugally. He was in the towers building, and he had overalls on. He was dirty, filthy dirty. But then he was able to come down, but he didn't want to spend too much time away from his work. He was more obsessed with finishing his work than he was visiting his family.
So this first idea about the towers being a piece of junk, and we don't go along with that as a value judgment, but this idea that what they're made out of is junk, trash, detritus, the outcast, this is a condition of materiality. It's come up in many of the readings that you will have done in the background for this week, but this is a crucial question for us to bring forward the issue of junk and waste, and to ask ourselves, what do these mean as a site condition for architecture? What does it mean to work with junk? What are the values of junk? And And what happens when we think about junk in relation to labour and creativity? What does that produce? So in fact, let's skip ahead here.
When you consider one man who was not much over 100 pounds handling over long periods of time the weight of materials, you can imagine somebody crawling a height of almost 100 feet several times during the day.
This excerpt, you know, shows us that there's what highlights a relationship between junk and labor, because it emphasizes the length of labor that Rodier had to use in order to convert these materials into the structure that he had in his mind. So within the site condition of junk, that also raises the question of labor and the kind of work and energy that's needed to convert that junk into form.
And you get up on a postman. I was working on a neck. Neck is weak. Get up on that.
I was one of the kids that used to help him gather the glass and break the bottles and stuff for him. And he'd give us a few cents for it. We'd go buy our candies, and on the way back, it's when we'd pick up the rocks and start throwing at him when he'd be up on top of the towers. And then he would tell us, okay, you kids, get out. So away we'd go, you know, trying to figure out why he got mad.
He'd always carry a gunny sack with him, and he would walk along the tracks with his sack, and he would stop and pick up stuff.
What this is telling us is that if we think about Simon Rodier as an architect, it shows you how embedded he is through his practice and through his practice of material collection with the community. And you heard there from one of the guys who was a kid when Rodier was making the towers, and how he became involved with this act of creation, and how the work, the labor of gathering together the materials was outsourced to the children, and how all of this was visible to the community, because you have other people here remembering what it was like for the kids and them to see and participate in the building of this structure. So the work of architecture, through the particular way that the architect handles materials and involves people in a collective act, this produces something more than an object, more than a kind of structure. It's producing relationships, it's producing community, and this is where we start to get into the realm of the undercommons, which is that we're thinking about objects and buildings and spaces which are inseparable from the social relationships which they tie together.
Sam had a very strong feeling of those colors. And he also had an enormous sense of the proximity of forms to forms. And he saw you could do some very extraordinarily delicate things that nature did in producing flowers and all the biological forms.
You just heard Buckminster Fuller, the architect and engineer, kind of speaking to and evaluating the structural significance of the Watts Towers. And you see here the manual operations that Rodier was using to turn these material into structural form. You know, and I just wanted to link and loop that back to some of the other materials thinking that we engaged in when we were thinking about materialities, looking at the way that Gaudí and Heinz Isler and Musmeci and the other architect engineers we looked at would use the inherent dynamic self-computing qualities of matter in order to produce their structures. And something, you know, Buckminster Fuller sees something similar, some like principles of natural structuration that exist within matter operating within Simon Rodier's work. So the Watts Towers are this highly complex set of relationships that link together many different possible concepts and you know, kind of theoretical speculations that we could make. But our interest today is really in how these towers have relate to their surrounding and the way that they produce relationships through material practices. And our goal is to think, is to work out from the towers a bit more broadly and to think about Watts as a location within Los Angeles that can center our thinking on material practices that are using these kind of marginal and outcast materials of low value and transforming them through work into something which we can start to call an undercommons, which is not just an object, but a whole set of conditions for collective social and human existence. Well, if Rodier's work had this aspect of collecting and assembling disparate pieces of junk or waste or trash, we can also look to other artists who were based in Watts in LA, who developed these practices in new directions in the kind of 60s and 70s and 80s, so in the decades immediately following the construction of the Watts Towers. And some of you will have read Lisa Udin's work, And Thus Not Glowing Brightly, a really brilliant essay which focuses on the work of the artist Noah Purifoy. And we're going to divert into that work for a moment now and try and expand it in a couple of ways. Now, Purifoy was a very interesting character because he had studied art, but he had also worked within the aerospace industry and had experience with industrial fabrication. And he also worked and had a great deal of experience over the course of his life in social work of various kinds, and was a brilliant educator and made education and teaching and sharing knowledge of material practices absolutely at the center of what he did. And you can see him here working with students. Now, one of Purifoy's most important interventions for us was directly in response to the Watts riots. And at that time he was based in Watts, and he was the director of an art center which had been founded just around that time that was located within the Watts Towers themselves. So the afterlife of the towers, after they had been completed, was that they became something other than just an idiosyncratic kind of monument to Simon Rodier. They were embraced by the community and turned into an art center. And the first director of that art center was in fact Noah Purifoy. And that the beginning of that art center corresponded with the riots. So it corresponded with a period of great antagonism, of disruption, when things were being kind of burnt and materially transformed by uprisings. And one of Purifoy's kind of responses to that situation was, after the riots, to go out into the streets of Watts, and a bit like Simon Rodier before him, go around collecting junk, what he referred to as junk, junk which had been produced by the fires and the kind of demolition of the riots. So it was a way of using the destruction that resulted from social uprisings as the base condition for a new kind of material practice that would result in amazing objects like these, which he himself referred to as assemblages. And this is how Purifoy defined the assemblage: two or more seemingly unrelated inanimate objects assembled constitutes the possibility of communication. Art of itself is of little or no value if in its relatedness it does not affect a change. We do not mean a change in appearance of physical things, but a change in the behavior of human beings. This is an idea of assemblage as two things. On the one hand, it's a material practice that assembles and brings together disparate or unlike artifacts. And that was something that Purifoy was able to do through his urban scavenging from the ruins of the Watts riots, to collect up materials and bring them together, create new proximities and combinations. But it wasn't only that. It wasn't, its purpose wasn't simply to, or only to produce new formal compositions, but it was to enact a transformation in the behavior of human beings. And that's why you can see in the documentation of Purifoy's work that he's surrounded by people, and he's directly engaging with other people through the medium of junk material. And in other projects that he was involved in that were situated in Watts, they had this emphasis on creating change and transformation in human behavior by producing interactions through material practices of making. And so here you see one of the art classes that was taking place with Judson Powell, who was a partner of Purifoy's in the Watts Towers Art Center. And they extended to wider-scaled community interventions, where groups of often young people, children, and young adults would take it upon themselves to perform actions within the urban environment of Watts, and supply for themselves and for their community acts of environmental or architectural maintenance or care to make up for what the state failed to provide, and what structural racism and inequalities within Los Angeles and US culture in general imposed on the area. And so you see this kind of commonality of practices between Simon Rodier and the Watts Towers, and the work of Noah Purifoy and others at the Watts Art Center. The combination of physical assembly of material and spatial objects with transformative social relations and community building, and the inseparability of these two things. And I think the point that we want to try and make by putting this into dialogue with Fred Moten and Stephen O'Hanley's work, is to try and argue that this constitutes an undercommons. It constitutes a world that's antagonistically related to the white settler colonial dominant regime, and produces alternative conditions through shared acts of making and building. There's been a lot of great work that's been kind of written about these subjects. Kelly Jones's book, South of Pico, if you're interested, expands more on the other artists who have worked in this realm. So, for example, we could look to artists like Betty Saar and see in this, it's not exactly 2D work, it's thick, it has dimensionality, it has kind of layering. But you see this very highly controlled work of assemblage, of bringing together and combining disparate elements found from multiple sources. In this piece called Essence of Egypt, we see a combination of, these are prints of ancient architectural scaled mural work from Egypt with other ancient Egyptian artifacts, but mounted on circuit board. So this ground of kind of electrical modernity becomes synthesized with this language of Egyptian hieroglyph and figuration from a much different time period. Or look at the work of Melvin Edwards, like Purifoy, someone who had a training in the industrial arts and fabrication. An assemblage here meant the assemblage of metal objects that had this extraordinary consistency in their materiality, in their hardness, in their edges, in the ductile qualities of the medium, and in the force that was evidently necessary in order to bend or weld or chain or fix these unlike objects into a new physical proximity, which constituted a new kind of whole, taking these disparate compositional elements, which like have nothing to do with one another, but then uniting them through their materiality in order to produce a strange object that emanates a kind of affect, which is above and beyond the sum of its parts. And there were many artists who worked within LA and California and the US more broadly. John Chamberlain, another artist who worked particularly in junkyards, picking up car parts, mangled car parts, and mangling them further, and using that junk, using that discarded material as a new medium. Now I think that we've got a more of a sense of junk as a condition, as a material condition of possibility. Let's just look and think a bit more carefully and speculatively about what kind of a thing junk is, and what kind of a thing assemblage is. And to do this, we can return to a text that we've looked at before, which is Jane Bennett's Vibrant Matter. And let's just go back into that work and see if we can theorize and conceptualize a bit more precisely what we mean by junk, but also just what we mean by matter, and matter as a thing with potential. So you remember that Jane Bennett spoke about this idea of thing power, that things, anything, not even a created human created object, but just like piles of things lying around, have a kind of power, And this is what is of interest to Bennett in looking at things. Bennett refers to it as an irreducibly strange dimension of matter, an outside. So strangeness, this outside, something which is slightly outside of the norm and which can't be reduced or broken down into anything smaller than its self. And you may remember, what's interesting is that Jane Bennett's first example of what this kind of thing power is in fact debris, or debris, as they say in America. This pile of debris that Bennett notices, it's a rat, a bottle cap, a stick of wood, a work glove, some oak pollen. It's this just coming across this pile of debris, of junk, of rubbish, is kind of an estranging, uncanny feeling, and it gives rise to this reflection on what they describe as the excruciating complexity and intractability of non-human bodies. The pile of debris, the pile of drunk, having this excruciating complexity and a strange aura of the non-human body. Even though it's non-human, it still seems to evoke often this bodily quality that enables us to identify with it. Well, this idea of the thing power of things then gets developed further by thinking about the combination and assemblage of things. And of course, this Bennett isn't so much talking about architecture, but we can continually keep this resonating for us with architecture. Architecture as an assemblage. What does it mean to think of architecture as an assemblage? It's clear for Bennett that no actant, so no piece of junk, no object, ever acts alone, but instead its efficacy or agency always depends on the collaboration, cooperation, or interactive interference of many bodies and forces, something you can refer to as a distributive agency. And let's, with this thinking in our mind, let's just go back to something like Purifoy's work. No one of these pieces of junk is acting alone, but the efficacy of this piece of assemblage art, it depends on the interactive interference between the different objects which are part of it. And you could say that was exactly the same as the Watts towers. Each one of these pieces of material has a history, it has an association, and it has a function within the overall assemblage of the tower. So this small level kind of decorative detail is working together with these much larger scale architectonic structures in an assemblage in which the agency of the object, of the thing, and its power is distributed across these many aspects of the assemblage. It's distributed across the surface details, it's distributed across the structural members and the forms and the individual towers in general. So this is what it means to think about an assemblage. And just one further thing, which is to note that Bennett makes a connection between things and assemblage, and things and assemblages always, and power. And this is something for us to keep in our minds. The power of an assemblage is special and particular, because it's not distributed equally across the surface. Assemblages are not governed by any central head. No one materiality or type of material has sufficient competence to determine consistently the trajectory or impact of the group. Just think about what that means for a second in, as it were, like social and political terms. It's talking about a group situation where the power is distributed. It's not governed by any single member. Nobody has power over the whole system, but each of the elements of the assemblage exerts its own power, it has its own force. And when you think of the assemblage as both a material and a social structure, that what the assemblage assembles are people as much as materials, I think you can begin to see how what we're talking about here in Watts is something that is approaching now the condition of the undercommons, the space in which assemblages are assembled. Material, architectural, spatial structures are assembled by particular collective, communal relationships and interactions, and that produces its own special kind of power, which lies outside of the normative dominant structures of LA society, LA architecture, and that this produces a kind of antagonism. Now, speaking of that antagonism, let's just kind of go in another direction that you could potentially go in when talking about junk and waste as material conditions for architectural creation, and say, well, what about someone like Frank Gehry, LA-based architect, who works with junk and thematizes junk or sort of cheapskate materials within his work. Even in the 70s, at the same time that Purifoy was working in the Watts Towers Art Center, Gehry made this quite famous series of the Easy Edges chairs. And as you can see, these were, although formally quite complex, materially they were rather simple because they were made of corrugated cardboard that was cut out in these profiles, and they were just lined up and glued together to produce a structural stability. And then in later projects, from the 90s and so on, this is a model proposal for Times Square. And you see very purposely this language of collapse, this language of undoing, this language of unbuilding and sort of falling apart, which can characterize the assemblage, is brought forward here into quite a new context of a commercial advertising kind of framework. And then here in a much later project, it's the formal logics of collapse and how materials sink and kind of suffer under strain, which is part of Gehry's working method. And you could look to other architects like Koop Himmelblau for this junk quality, a quality maybe of the assemblage, where things are kind of quickly and roughly put together to retain this sense of inhabiting a kind of productive boundary space between the stable and the unstable, the formed and the formless. Now, the kind of question or the antagonism, though, that we want to, I think, want to kind of introduce here has to do not so much with formal operations, because I think we could say some of those are shared between, say, Gehry's work and Noah Purifoy's work with assemblages, but to think about the antagonism of the surround and where the architect situates themselves in relationship more broadly to a social collective, to the immediate conditions in which they live. And we've been looking at Purifoy and Simon Rodier as being inseparable from the collective conditions of human existence in which they lived, unified among diverse groups by common experiences of poverty and inequality. Now, does Gerry position himself in a similar situation? Is Gerry working within and with and in collaboration with a community of some kind? Or is it rather operating in a different cultural, social, political space that has to do with highly capitalized, funded projects, with maybe upper level official routes of urban planning, with a kind of professional client-based set of relationships, which are mediated not so much by neighborly proximity, but instead by the supposedly rational forces of the market. So this is an architecture which exists either within a professional or within an academical realm. And I think whilst it has undoubted interest for us in purely formal terms, or perhaps in professional or commercial terms, I think there's a question over whether or not this kind of architecture constitutes something like an undercommons, a radical act of human transformation and assemblage in order to produce new forms of collective life. That's a question that I leave kind of with you to argue with, if of course you wish. Let's kind of begin to close out now by looking at the kind of legacy of this work within Watts and within LA. The work of Lauren Holsey is interesting for us because, like Rodia, like Purifoy, Holsey occupies this edge condition between the architect and the artist. Holsey trained in architecture and works at an architectural scale, but Holsey's work is most often spoken about and received within an art context. So Holsey's work was recently on the cover of Art Forum. And of course, you know, this very strong and particular relationship established, an identification between Holsey as a creator and the Watts Towers, which are in the background. And a lot of Lauren Holsey's work has come out of collage-based practices. And of course, the relationship between collage and assemblage is very, very close. Both of them bring together disparate, unalike objects or images and put them into new proximities and thereby establish new relationships. And these, a lot of this imagery is brought straight from the streets of Watts and South LA generally. And like the Betty Saar objects we saw, also engages with kind of mythologies and broader, deeper historical materials. And the South Central Hieroglyphs project, in fact, let's see if we can look at this online, is a project for CNC milled concrete or gypsum panels that take inscriptions and imagery, urban imagery, from the streets and scale it up and rematerialize it into a different set of material conditions so that it can take on an architectural scale. And you see how these panels, there we are. These panels, become monumentalized in scale. So the graffiti or the street sign, when assembled together and transposed into a different medium, they can then take on another scale and engage publicly and spatially as architecture. We'll close out here by looking at some of the work of Theaster Gates. In this case, actually, an artist slash architect, again, like Halsey and Purifoy and Simon Rodier, someone who occupies that boundary. Theaster Gates, based more actually in Chicago than LA, but whose work exhibits important continuities with what we've been speaking about. And, you know, this is a kind of 2.5D work by Theaster Gates. It's displayed, hung on a wall, as if it were a painting. But as you may be able to identify, the strips of this wood are reclaimed basketball court. And so the object testifies to a process and a history of reclamation, of change within the urban fabric of a community, and it brings that history with it. And then, rather than being sort of nostalgic or lamenting over the loss of this basketball court, it reassembles the parts of that object into a new condition, a new wall condition, which indicates, in general, you know, the possibility that through labor, through creative labor, waste materials, junk basketball courts can be reclaimed and restored to an alternative and new existence. Now, this, just as we come to the end here, just want to introduce one further kind of refinement of the concepts that we're working with. And that's by referring here to the work of Sara Ahmed from a very important book, Queer Phenomenology, Orientations, Objects, and Others. And this opening chapter, Orientations Toward Objects, has many important ideas. But the one that I'd like to particularly pick up on is the idea of the sticky object. And the sticky object is an object that picks up on its surface or shows where it has traveled and what it has come into contact with. This stickiness is a material property, and it means that an object, whatever object it is, as it goes through the world, as it accumulates a history, that history sticks to its surface, and the history becomes kind of legible on the object. The object becomes a sign or a kind of monument to the stages of life, to its autobiography, to all the things that it's passed through, all of the hands that it's passed through, all of the things that have been done to it, and the way that it has arrived in its moment. I think this is a beautiful idea, the arrival of an object. No object is simply there, but it arrives in time, at a particular time. It makes an entrance into the world. So the sticky object, you know, this takes us back to the idea of matter, materiality, as evidence. You know, think again of the meat. You know, that's sticky, it's got maggots on it. The maggots are stuck to the meat. The meat is a sticky object. It's carrying with it a history. And in the history of that meat is contained the whole revolutionary history of the antagonism between the Russian, in Russian society. Well, what if we also think about the Watts Towers, of course, as a sticky object, concrete is sticky. That's what enables you to cover it with this amazing gathered jewelry of junk with the glass and pottery fragments, each one of which evokes in some sense its own history of usage of possession within the neighborhood of Watts. So we think of the whole towers as a sticky object, an object which has, and of course, say exactly the thing, the assemblage is all about stickiness. It's all about sticking things together, making them attach so that they can testify, so that they can connect. Welding is about stickiness. It's about making metal sticky so that it can be combined and assembled and thereby carry these histories and the significances that the materiality of the object can convey. Now, a lot of Theaster Gates's work has to do with reclamation on the scale of the community. And we will just close out here by listening to some of what Theaster Gates has to say about his practice, and think of this particularly as a way of combining the stickiness of objects with engagements with the community and engagements with material and space in order to produce something what we can call an undercommons.
In a way, if we were thinking about a total practice, that I always find myself thinking about painters. Like a painter could say, subjectivity is not important. That really I'm interested in materiality or conveying color, or you know, and I choose for subjectivity these fruit. Fruit don't matter. I just happen to use it. That in a way, in my own practice, I feel like there's something that's core, like painting, except I don't know what to call it. It has to do with space and one's ability to manipulate materiality, but at a very wide level, a very wide array, that I feel like what I'm engaged in is these acts of transformation. And whether the transformation is from mud to a clay body to a clay form, or an abandoned building to a semi-usable building to a really established cultural center, or the transformation of a museum space or a gallery space from what an audience member might imagine it to be to something else that I want it to be, that these moments of transformation are quite important to me. And so I think regarding buildings, there is something that is instinctive that wants to look for a big problem and then solve it. And then when the problem is solved, a lot of the magic is gone. But what I'm finding is that there's a way in which one part of my problem is the restoration of space, or the reactivation or the redemption of a space. But another part is, once the space is redeemed, that is, it's usable, I'm also very interested in what happens in the building, right? So there's a way in which this building that we're in, half of it was about restoring the building and making it something that was interesting. The other part was the building became a vessel for a body of cultural objects that I wanted to be able to share with the public. And so, you know, we spent 2 years building the building, and then the next 2 or 3 years making it an accessible space as a kind of library.
That is the question for us, I think, to take on now for ourselves. Which is the question of the undercommons. To think, what materials are we working on? Where have they come from? What are their histories? To whom do they belong? Who do they involve? Who is able to participate through them? Where do they come from? How do they get there? Through what labor do they arrive? And who is assembled by those architectural practices of making? What kind of communities are created? What kind of relationships are established? And what kind of antagonisms are engaged with? And where is our time and our energy positioned? And how much time, in fact, are we willing to dedicate to each project? And what kind of time frame? And how long are we willing to dedicate to a project? Will it be 30 years, like Simon Rodier, or shorter? I think this idea of the citizen architect, the architect of the undercommons, is a model of practice which I hope that we'll be able to think about further when we meet to discuss. So thanks for listening. I hope that the extra readings that you've been able to do will provide more layers and more complexities and alternative perspectives on this material, and we'll be able to look at those and speak further together when we meet.